Okay, so a very good evening to all the participants who have joined us today. This three-day mega series on critical issues on direct taxation. I would like to thank all the participants who have joined us at this hour of the day. AFTP along with WebTel has organized this session. Now to introduce the topic and the speakers of day, I would hand it over to CA Pitam Goyalji, who is the president of AFTP, Association of Finance and Tax Professionals. Over to you, Pitam.
Very good afternoon to all the participants, friends. AFTP and WebTel would like to welcome all the delegates for this new series on the critical issues in direct taxation, friends. AFTP would also like to welcome our guest of honor for today, CA Sanjay Agarwal ji, and our esteemed speaker for today, CA Rajiv Khandelwal ji. Friends, it seems that we have a good audience at 4 p.m. today. We are also live on our YouTube channel. As a president of AFTP, just to introduce AFTP, AFTP, Association of Finance and Tax Professional, is a national level body consisting of chartered accountants, lawyers, company secretaries, cost management accountants, as well as other professionals. AFTP has been subdivided into various committees, such as valuation committees, audit assurance committee, IDT committee, direct tax committee, banking and finance committee, and the executive committee. Currently, we are a team of more than 500 members as on date, and there are more than 250 executive committee members who are striving for the knowledge enhancement as the main objective of AFTP. There are also other objectives of AFTP. Firstly, the objective of AFTP is to extend, spread and support the research work and the output in the fields of audit, accountancy, financial management, personal finance, tax management, tax planning, legal awareness, then management consultation and other related activities. Second objective of AFTP is to equip its members to enable them to discharge their obligations towards their clientele or towards the trade with regard to the knowledge sharing. The third is that we want to help our members to stay updated with the recent developments around the industry and profession so that we can serve our clientele in a much better way. Friends, in the past few months, we have already conducted various series with regard to various topics such as Ind AS, such as international taxation, such as GST, insolvency, and the Excel related and the tally related things. With the current need of ours, we have collaborated with WebTel to have the series on the critical issues related to the direct taxation. On the day one, that is today, we will try to cover Section 147, 148, 148A with regard to the assessment provisions, and our speaker CA Rajiv Khandelwal ji will elaborate upon the new and the old schemes and the recent changes in the ITR form for the assessment year 2021 till 2022. On the second day, that is tomorrow, we shall discuss about the faceless assessments as well as new TDS and the TDS provisions such as 206AB, 206CCA and the other related provisions. On the day three, we shall discuss the issues related to the charitable trust and the foreign remittance. And later on, we shall study the impact of the recent amendments on the M&A transaction, such as goodwill, the impact of goodwill, whether the goodwill will be allowed as a amortization benefit or not in case of purchase acquisition, slum sales, recent amendment with regard to the valuation rules. Then the partnership clause, which have been amended with respect to Section 45, is again an important thing. So we have structured this series in a way to keep it as much practical as we can with regard to the general profession members in practice or our industry. With this background in mind, let us welcome our guest of honor for today, CS Sanjay Agarwal ji. Just to introduce Sanjay Agarwal ji, being politically and professionally very active, he does not need any formal introduction for sure. But for the brevity of the audience, we are just sharing a snapshot of his key accolades, friends. Sanjay Agarwal ji is a fellow chartered accountant and having more than 35 years of experience in the professional practice. In the past, he has been a central council member of ICAI for the council term 2010 till 2019. He has also served as a professional of chartered accountants as the chairman of NIRC of ICAI for the year 2004 till 2005. He is regular speaker on various issues related to direct taxation. With this, we would like to welcome you on board for your esteemed deliberation, sir.
Thank you, Pritam bhai. Present on webinar, the great friend C.A. Rajiv Khandelwal from WebTel. And whenever we are in trouble, we always go and ask him to do some troubleshooting, and he is always available, and he is very generous with the chartered accountants because of he himself is a chartered accountant. And AFTP president Pritam Goyalji, CA Pritam Goyalji, the other team of the WebTel and AFTP, those who are involved in this mega series on this. Pritam bhai, I would like to just ask two things. One is this, that as you have said in the beginning, that Rajiv bhai will be speaking on return of income and amendments.
Yes, sir.
Both the topic, and since in this 147-148, I made some presentation. If how much time is allotted to me now?
Sir, 30 minutes.
How much?
30 minutes, sir.
Okay. So, with 30 minutes...
Sir, 45 minutes you can exceed, sir, because the second topic is not that long. So, 45 okay. minutes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So, whatever organizer says, let me tell you, friends, when the new provision were introduced, a lot of people... they have cheer in the mind that now the income tax department cannot open cases beyond 3 years, and new cases will be in the new regime. But since the taxation amendment act continued to
Sanjay sir, please unmute yourself. Yes.
I'm unmuted.
Audible, sir.
Yeah. So we continue to get the notices due to extension. And when after 31st March 21, still by way of notification, the date extended beyond 31st March and now ended on 30th June itself. So a lot of people were asking us that what we should do. You see, challenging in legislation will always be a challenge. And as such, we also prepared some of the grounds, and we also said, yes, look, there has to be a certainty. There cannot be an uncertainty in any provision of the law. And as such, various high courts, including yesterday, Karnataka High Court, beside Delhi, Mumbai, and other high court, Karnataka also gave the stay. And what I have been told in the backdrop at the board level, at the ministry level, there are certain, you can say, error in the drafting. Because what I find that at one time on one particular section, there cannot be more than one provision which is there. So now this is something which is on legal side. Now on the factual side, if you go to the portal, only few days back only the you can say window is open for filing of the 148 return. Now, since people are struggling to file various other return, the portal has accepted, but there are certain problems regarding the calculation of the interest. and especially regarding the no schema being released from the department to the various service provider, and service provider are not in a position to provide us any software by which we can file the return through the service provider software. So we have to take out the XML file, we have to upload, we have to see this, check it. So it's a little bit cumbersome over there, but returns are being filed. Now, when I'll make my presentation, when I'll show you various provisions, what is new, what is old, what is the difference, where are the legal lacuna, where we can do something to help the SSE to put the certain facts. So I'll try to dissect, I'll try to analyze the provision of old and the new. Now, the point that we should understand that the participant, those who are there, they should get the answer of their queries. So I'll be restricting my time to around 30 minutes for the purpose of presentation, and then 15 minutes rest of the, if the organizer permits, then we'll have the question answer. Let me tell you one disclaimer in this. This is a new section. Every time when I read it, every time when I go through, I find something new. A lot of questions which are coming to my mind are not having any answer today. When the notices will be issued in the new regime, when the people will get the notices, the mandatory provision which the government has provided over there, if that will come, then we will come to know how the legislatures will implement the new law. But let me tell you, it was a welcome step, because in the old regime, a reason to believe were supplied after you file a return, and then you keep on struggling. AO will not be listening, he will complete. I have found in my 35-year career only 4 or 5 cases wherein 148 have been dropped by the department suo moto after filing the reasons or consigned to the records. But in the 99% cases, the 148 continued, and they continue to assess, and later on in the courts we have a lot of fight, and the matter traveled to High Court, Supreme Court on the 148 itself. So this is something, a provision in the law which were being handled by various councils at various level, various points, which have come in the development of 148. But now that 148 is over, the new wine in a old new old wine in a new bottle with a new flair, new scent, and new essence, which has come in this. So I would like to share my presentation.
Visible.
Okay. I'm making it full. Now I'm reducing myself. Any organizer, if he's there, he can tell me if the questions are there.
Yes, sir.
Or anything is there. So friends, this section has been substituted from 1st April 2021. And there are a lot of things which have been provided in this section in order to plug hole which were there in the old regime. Now, just for the sake of, you can say, reading the plain text, then I will take you to the intricacy of the dissection. I will do it. Now, if any income chargeable to tax, it has to be chargeable to tax, escaped assessment for any assessment year. So it has to be an escaped assessment. It must not have been escaped by the department. And the provisions subject to 148 to 153. So earlier also the same section were there. Then what they can do, assess or reassess. If you are already assessed, they can reassess. If you are a first timer filer and you have not filed your return and department have been able to find out something, so they can assess you for the first time also under the escape assessments. Then they can recompute the loss, depreciation allowance, etc. And section 148, which includes 148 capital A, the most people will try to see this section, and it has a lot of you can say points where the exchequers has to have clarification, and I'll try to deal some of the point so that our professional brothers, if they face it, at least they can challenge on that point. Then you see there was a earlier a provision, or you can say stand, which has been held by various high court, including the Delhi High Court in Jet Airways, wherein it has been held that look, suppose if you reopen my case for, let us say, a transaction in the share capital, where it has been alleged to me that I have concealed the particulars of a bogus share capital of, let us say, 15 lakh rupees from Mr. X. Now, what happened in the cases that the SSE used to cry, sir, this 15 lakh transaction is not in my record at all, and there is no case wherein you can allege me on that 15 lakh rupees. Now, what used to happen, that as it is usual, that since there were case laws which were earlier there in the law, wherein it was said that if suppose you have opened a case for X thing, you cannot go for Y thing, and you cannot exceed your jurisdiction, you cannot exceed your mandate beyond that. But somehow the legislatures have given the explanation, added the explanation, and in that explanation, what they said, I'll read for you, that for the purpose of assessment or reassessment, as the case may be, the assessing officer may assess or reassess the income in respect of any issue which has escaped assessment, and such issue come to his notice subsequently in the course of proceedings. So now what they started asking, 1,000 more things. Now in one of the case which I was handling, I've been told by the client, look, the question which is being opened is having only a 5% or 1% of the total risk factor which is there in my case. And as such, a conscious decision have been taken that we are not going to file the details. And we continue to fight it on the legal ground that you do not have any base, nothing is there. And we have filed only limited particular, only to the extent of what the reopening reason was given to us. However, when the assessment came, at that time, what we find that he has added the increase in the creditor. He has added increased the sales. He has increased the disallowed the expenditure being not provided us. And beside making the addition on account of which the addition was supposed to be made. Now what happened? We went into the appeal and then we filed additional evidence and also. But you see, it was worth taking a risk, because now the total process was limited and it was before us. But in certain cases where the original amount on which the allegation was made but was not added at all, and certain new addition have been made, so courts have said no, this is not possible. If the original reason itself does not, there is not existing, then you can't make any addition. You have to do the another 148. Now, in new provision which is now there, this particular thing still exists and the situation will remain same, because I'll explain you in the table form both the picture. Now, the biggest departure, because of the lot of information which is being collected by the department in the risk management strategy, and lot of information which are gathered through your mobile, your credit card, your PAN, your Aadhaar, your investment, and all other sales, TDS, TCS, and then 140, now this new TDS on 194N, lot of new information which the department is getting. Now the department making a departure from the old regime, that a reason has to be there, and that reason, not only it should be there, but there has to be a reason to believe, and then application of mind of the higher officials. Making a departure from this, in the new, the word reason to believe had been dropped, and the AO having the very big power in the old provisions have been curtailed, and lot of checks and balances were made in the new provision. And I'll try to tell you that still, even if it is dropped, still there are places where we may not ask a reason to believe, but we may ask for the reason and make it in a such a manner that believe, or the base, I will not say believe, but the base of having that reason itself is wrong. Now, this is something the English language. I always used to say that the dictionary meaning of some words are akin to various other words, but if the interpretation are taken, then in that case it may result into a different altogether meaning. For example, if I tell my wife that you are cheap, then you know what I will get. I will get a slap. She will go. She will give me a divorce. But if I tell her that you are economical, then she will certainly love me. But if I go to the dictionary, Oxford dictionary, and if I want to see what mistake I have done in telling my wife, because I do not have the vocabulary of the cheap and the economical, when I go and see, I find that cheap and economical both are in one same definition itself, but it has a lot of difference. So now reason to believe has to be challenged with the reason, and reason of decision making may not be believed. How it has to be done, we'll deal. Now, so impact is this, that the 148 proper opportunity will come, which were not there prior to filing of the return. The entire process used to start in the old regime from the filing of return. Those participants, those who are younger, they may not be knowing, but those who are seniors, they will know that the entire machinery starts only from the filing of the return. Or you have an option at that time to straight away go to the court under a writ remedy, if you know it, that the reason to believe does not exist. The courts have defined the old reason to believe and reason to suspect very carefully. Court said that reason to suspect cannot give a right to the department to reopen the proceeding and reassess the income or assess the income. But in any case, reason to believe is stronger. It's wider, it means something which has evidentiary value. It means there is something which is there. The way the cases are opened in 30th June in the old regime, let me tell you, in 70% of the cases, if we have the trail, if we ask for the digital trail from the department under some RTI or somewhere, then what we will find that the assessing officers have reopened the assessments merely on suspicions. They were not being supplied with the tenable material. They were not having in their control the tenable material. And as such, the lot of litigation is going to happen where the larger stakes are involved. Now, as I was discussing that if there is no issue on which it was opened and no addition have been made on that account and another additions or the other incomes are being assessed instead of the original reason for which it has been opened. So a very famous case of Jet Airways, Adnik Niryat in the Delhi High Court and the 31 taxman Mumbai and 30 taxman Gujarat also held the same thing, and they say it is not possible for you to assess new source, new incomes other than the old one. However, if you are having the allegation and that allegation you are proving it, you are assessing, for example, X allegation was made and an addition was made for X and then Y, Z, Z1, Z2, it is possible. You can't say, because Punjab Haryana used to say earlier, then they have added the explanation and it is no more. So this is the situation which I wanted to explain. Now, this 148. So now in 148, what they say that, just it will be subject to 147, 148A and so on. And you need to follow the procedure. So another facet have been added. The permissions are embedded in this. Now, if you have to open for up to three previous year, then you need to take the prior approval of the specified authority, the principal commissioner or commissioner, director, and if it is beyond three previous year and up to 10 year, then you have to go to the higher authority, the director general, chief commissioner, principal chief commissioner, you need to go. The AO has to go there. He has to give the information and then ask for the permission to issue the notice. However, few explanation have been added because you see, when I started my career way back in 86, there used to be no special assessment procedure for the search cases or the survey cases. Now later on, 158 BC came, 10 year of assessment used to be together. Then 153A came. Now that 153A and C, which were there for the search machinery or cases where search have been done, that has been now given a sunset clause, and any search which is being conducted prior to 31st March 2021 will be dealt by erstwhile 153A and C, and any search which is conducted after 31st March or you can say after 1st April, on or after 1st April 2021, in that case, the provisions of 153A, B, C will not apply and they are submerged or merged in the provision of 147, 148. Now, let us say if the assessing officer will not have a reason to believe, then what he will have? How he will get the information? How he will come to know that, yes, it's a fit case for escape assessment? Now, 10 information can come. For example, I was doing a case where long back, a search was conducted only on this ground that the assessee is participating in the auctions by the income tax department. And the money paid on the close of the auction or deposited for the security money is in terms of crores. And when in the form it was asked that what is your PAN number, it is said not applicable. And as such, it gives rise to the department that looked something fishy is there and they have searched. Now later on, it was found in the famous case of L.R. Gupta 132 ITR that look, suspicion cannot give rise to the search. So now in this case, now the assessing officer role from reason to believe has been reduced to believe or rely. I am using the word rely on what, if he wanted to do the escape assessment machinery on. One, the information which are flagged in the risk management strategy. And let me tell you, today, this risk management strategy is not open to the public. It is called 360 degree analysis. Now, if I purchase a property above 30 lakh rupees, it will go to the risk management strategy. Now, suppose I am not filing a return or I am filing a return with a very small amount and I am purchasing a property of 5 crore rupees, then will this risk management strategy give a flag to the assessing officer? Yes. Now, it means if you are aggrieved with the risk management strategy, you have to have exercise an option to going to the court, seeking the information, what is the base, how can a risk management strategy can result into an escape assessment. But in some cases, yes, I may have borrowed from the bank. I may have got some lottery where the TDS have been deducted. Or the second thing on the basis of which an escape assessment machinery can be started is any final objection by CAG. CAG makes a preliminary objection, reply is sought from the department, then department reply, and finally an objection is raised sometime by the CAG. Now let me tell you, friends, when the objection is being raised by the CAG, in that case, normally it is not opened directly by saying that it is a CAG, but CAG reports are public. So, for example, in the case of tax audit report analysis, the CAG has given some example. And they say it is done in the rest of the cases, so many cases. Now, here, what is important is that the CAG must raise an objection in the case of the impugned assessee, alleged assessee itself. It should not be hearsay, a general report where name has surfaced. It should be done specifically by CAG audit team in the case of the assessee itself. So these are the two important limbs on the basis of which the AO will presume. AO will presume that an action is required or not. Then, what else he will do? He will seek a permission, as I said earlier, from the commissioner, or if it is beyond 3 years, from the chief commissioner. And then the machinery will start. But there is a carve out, as I said, that the search assessments have been carved out from 153A and they have been brought into the 148. Now in 148, the search assessment said, for this purpose, of this section in the case of 132 or 132A after 1st April, or in the case of survey under 133A or 153C, akin to 153C, there are two provisions. Anything which is found from somebody else in the search of someone, then a presumption can be taken. In this case, there will be no need for going through the regular procedure what the legislature want, that we will presume that yes, it's an escape assessment. Now it is something I need to read with the other sections also, because in explanation 2 there are four type of the exceptions for which there will be no flow of information either from the risk management or from the CAG. It will be through the action under section 132, 132A or 133A or akin to 153C. Something is found, for example, agar A ke search hui aur B ke kuch kagaj wahan pe aise mil gaye, to wo B ko bhi aap is explanation mein cover kar lenge. Ya A ke search mein koi B ke asset mil gayi, कोई लॉकर की मिल गई, कोई ऐसी चीज मिल गई, तो आप उसको कवर कर लेंगे, विच इज प्राइम अफेसिया अनडिस्क्लोज्ड. नाउ दिस इज समथिंग व्हाट इज इंपॉर्टेंट, आई विल टेल यू. नाउ इफ आई रीड इन बिटवीन लाइन, सो फार एज द एसएससी हु इज सर्च्ड, देयर इज नथिंग विच इज रिक्वायर्ड बियॉन्ड टेकिंग द परमिशंस एंड फॉर 3 ईयर इट विल बी done. You have to do the assessment in the case of survey also. But what happened in the case of the other persons? Here specifically the legislatures have used the word assessing officer is satisfied. So the satisfaction which was left in the erstwhile section and was tried to be removed from the reason to believe, because reason to believe has to have a satisfaction. This satisfaction have been brought in these two limb. If those who are doing search cases, I would like to summarize that as in the case of 153C cases, it will not be an automatically assessment. It has to have a satisfaction. So this is something what I wanted to. And specified authority, I have already explained, it is there. So now in nutshell, I would like to say that 153A or C has been given a departure, has been go goodbye, and it has been incorporated in this. Information have been flagged to two things, risk management strategy, and that in the case of the 3 preceding year, you can go beyond 3 if you want to go, then you should have assets, likely to be having assets and income beyond 50 lakh rupees, then only you can go beyond 3 years to 10 years. Now, small chart. What I wanted to say earlier, 6 years in the case of search assessment, 10 if you have more than 50 in 1 year or in aggregate of everything. But now in the new provision, instead of 6 year, it is 3 year, and then another 7 year. But each year has to have more than 50 lakh rupees of assets. Assets, important to note that it is the representation in the form of the asset. Khaliya piliya uda diya nahi, kyunki asset ko inhone define kiya. Now let us come to the new provision, how the machinery will work. Straight away 148 will not be there. 148A has to be invoked first for the cases other than search. There are different school of thoughts. People say in the case of the survey also, 148A will not be there. I beg to differ with some of the authors, but the carve out is given only in the 148 for the search cases. Now, what is the procedure? The AO has to conduct an inquiry, but he can't do. अभी market में घूमने चले गए और वहाँ जाके पसंद नहीं आया किसी को कि भाई ये आदमी ठीक से काम नहीं कर रहा तो उसके आप सर्वे कर दे. उसको वही 148 का नोटिस पड़ा दे, पकड़ा दे. No. AO has to conduct an inquiry, but he has to take first prior approval of the higher authority. Then, next. Once he takes in permission, he has to provide me an opportunity of being heard. Now, what are the time limits, timelines? He cannot give me a notice less than 7 days. And he can give me time up to 30 days. But friends, I would like to tell you that there are provision in the income tax which says the date of service to the SSE is important. Not the date of issue is important. But if you go and read in this case, the date of issue is the trigger point. And it will be starting from 7 to 30 days, or it may be extended by the AO. You are on his mercy. For example, if I get a notice for 10 days, you have to reply, you're given an opportunity to explain, show cause. Now I apply for an extension, let us say on 9th day, and he says, okay, I give you one more day, 11th day, and he refuses to extend further, then what you have to do? You have to reply within that time, or if you do not reply, then from the end of that month, for example, agar mere ko usne bola 10 tarikh tak aapko jawab dena hai, maine extension mangi, usne bola 11 ko de dena, wo baat alag hai ki hum court mein jaye, hum jaake kahe sir unreasonable hai, proper opportunity mili ye nahi mila wo nahi mila, wo baat ki baat hai. But if he says you have to reply me by 11, I do not reply or file a reply, then from the end of this month, let us say it is July, then from 31st July, within 30 days, he has to pass an order. On the reply, if it is there, on a reply which is not there, if there is no reply, within 30 days, he has to file. But if he extends beyond 30 days, then after that date is being extended, in this, it is not written that extension will be once, extension will be twice. Agar usne mujhe 30 din extend kar diya, phir maine ek chitti laga di, sahab meri to tabiyat kharab hai. Wo generous tha, unne kaha chalo koi baat nahi, dekhte hain kab tak bhagte tum, humko 15 din ka aur time de diya. Phir teesri baar phir maine laga diya, chauthi baar phir laga diya, yahan kuch nahi bataya sir. Jis din usne mujhe extension band kar di, jis din last de di, us month ki end se 30 days ke andar andar usko order pass kar, show cause find. Or when you will see that when I was showing you 148, three type of the people were not supposed to be flowing the information from the risk management or from the CAG: search cases, survey cases, and requisition cases, and also act into 153C. But when I read in 148A, he says this provision will not apply, means the procedure of issuing me notice, giving me time, taking the reply, giving the show cause notice, and then finally issuing 148 will not apply in the cases of the search of 132 or 132A. Yahan pe aake ya to ye bhool gaye ya inhone janbujh ke survey cases ko cover nahi kiya hai. And there are school of thought which says survey cases bhi compulsorily 3 saal ke liye reassessment mein jayenge. Sir, kaise ja sakte hain? 1 saal ki return file karunga, 3 saal ka aapko koi cheez hai nahi, मैंने बिजनेस मान लीजिए अभी शुरू किया तो कंपलसरी असेसमेंट कैसे कर देंगे, मान लीजिए मैं वो सोर्स ही नहीं था जिस सोर्स में आपने मुझे सर्वे किया, मैं बिजनेस नहीं करता था, सैलरी थी मेरी, हाउ यू कैन ओपन? सो आई बेग टू डिफर विद सम ऑफ द ओपिनियन. व्हाट आई से इन द केस ऑफ द सर्वे, यस फॉर 3 ईयर यू डू नॉट हैव टू गो फॉर द प्रोसीजर, बट 148 ए प्रोसीजर हैज टू बी कैरिड आउट, बट इन द केस ऑफ सर्च नो. सो दिस इज समथिंग व्हाट आई वांट टू एक्सप्लेन. अब चलिए सर, ये जो हमारे पुराने लोगों को जो नोटिसेस इशू हुए हैं उनके लिए क्या क्या पॉइंट कवर होने चाहिए वो वी हैव ट्राइड टू कवर. कि एक तो हमको ये ऑब्जेक्शन रेज करना पड़ेगा इस पॉइंट पे, इसकी एक डिटेल बनी है, अगर कोई लोग आप चाहेंगे तो मैं उनको बाद में दे दूंगा, अभी मैंने इसमें डिटेल नहीं दी है. इट वॉज इन 10 पेज कि आप एक्सपायरी के 3 साल बाद इशू नहीं कर सकते, दूसरी बात आपका 148 का प्रोसीजर नहीं लिया, तीसरा ये जो टोला है ये आप बियॉन्ड पावर नोटिफिकेशन से एक्सटेंड नहीं कर सकते. इस तरीके से आपको जो है ये जो है वो ऑब्जेक्शन करने. प्रीतम भाई कोई क्वेश्चन हो तो मैं yes, उसको आपके ले सकता हूँ, बिकॉज आई एम और ये हाई कोर्ट बता दी. एनी क्वेश्चन?
Yes.
जी सर.
सर देयर इज अ क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम मिस्टर,
या इज इट इन क्यूए बॉक्स,
फ्रॉम मिस्टर शिव कुमार झा.
यस सर.
Whether notice under section 148 dated 30 June 2021 received on email after 6 p.m. That is received on 1 July at 3 a.m. on email. It is valid.
सर 12 बजे तक रात को आ जाने चाहिए थे, पर आपको एश्योर करना है कि उसकी डिलीवरी 3 बजे हुई है. डिजिटल ट्रेल रखनी पड़ेगी. ईमेल नहीं है आपके माई अकाउंट में कितने बजे डाले, आपको एक RTI फाइल करनी पड़ेगी.
ओके
आपके माई अकाउंट में कितने बजे डाले, क्योंकि जो फेसलेस असेसमेंट में उन्होंने कहा हमने डाल दिए अपने कंप्यूटर में, तो ये हम प्रज्यूम कर लेंगे कि आपको मिल गए, तो वो आपको डिजिटल ट्रेल लेनी पड़ेगी.
ओके सर.
और 3 बजे सवेरे नहीं, 12 बजे तक देने थे 30 जून को. आप चैलेंज करिए उसको, डिपार्टमेंट अपने आप कागज देगा.
श्योर सर. एंड he is also asking about the case law which you mentioned of Karnataka High Court in which he granted.
Just दिल्ली बॉम्बे कर्नाटका यस्टरडे. अरे कुलजा भाई आई विल फ्लैग डाउन, आई विल गिव यू. ये एक्चुअली कुछ गड़बड़ हो गई लग रहा है. एक सेकंड. यस अब आए. इट इज ओपनिंग जस्ट. ये सर दिल्ली का है, मुद्रा फाइनेंस में 2-3 केसेस और भी हैं दिल्ली के. इन्होंने बॉम्बे हाई कोर्ट रिलाई किया है. ये आपका कलकत्ता का है. ये आपका बॉम्बे का है. आई गिव इट. और ये आपका 3 जून का है. ये नहीं, ये अपना ये भी नहीं है. इसके बाद
सर आपकी स्क्रीन, आई थिंक यू हैव टू चेंज योर स्क्रीन, पीपीटी दिख रहा है.
पीपीटी फॉर्म में है अभी, मैं आपको इनको मैं दे दूंगा, कर्नाटका ने कल ही किया है।
श्योर श्योर सर,
ठीक है जी, आपको दे दूंगा, आप दे दीजिएगा, इनको नोट कर लीजिएगा। हाँ जी, और क्वेश्चन पूछे।
देर इज अनदर क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम सी ए मयंक महेश्वरी जी, ही इज आस्किंग इफ देर इज नो एडिशन मेड अंडर सेक्शन 148, कैन एओ पुट पेनल्टी अंडर अदर नॉन कंप्लायंसेस?
अगर एडिशन ही नहीं हुआ, सारी की सारी पेनल्टियां अदर देन नॉट फाइलिंग द इंफॉर्मेशन, वो सारी की सारी पेनल्टियां जो है वो आपकी इनकम से कनेक्टेड है। मान लीजिए लॉस है, लॉस कम हो गया तो जरूर कर सकता है, पर अदरवाइज कोई नहीं बने, क्योंकि जो मशीनरी प्रोविजन है जिससे कंप्यूट होगी पेनल्टी क्वांटम, उसके अंदर आपकी एसेस इनकम ही आएगी, तो नहीं लगा पाएंगे, आपको एग्जांपल देना पड़ेगा, इट शुड नॉट बी अ थ्योरेटिकल क्वेश्चन।
एक्सट्रीमली सॉरी फ्रेंड्स, सो संजय सर, देयर वाज सम टेक्निकल इश्यूज एट माय एंड, सो आई जस्ट रीजॉइंड अगेन। I hope Sumit is taking the questions.
Yes, yes.
There is another query from CA Kishore Goyal ji. Kishore, we have unmuted you, if you can ask.
Hello.
हाँ जी किशोर जी।
हाँ सर, ये एक्चुअल में 148 का जो प्रोसीजर है, 148 में रिटर्न फाइल करने के बाद में आपको रीजन मिलता है, और आई एम प्रोटेस्टिंग अगेंस्ट द डिपार्टमेंट रिगार्डिंग आई विल नॉट फाइल द रिटर्न ऑफ इनकम बिकॉज सेक्शन 148 हैव नो मैंडेट टू डायरेक्ट मी टू फाइल द रिटर्न ऑफ इनकम।
सर कम से कम नहीं तो 50 केसेस में लोग फेल हो गए, लेकिन आपके पास रेमेडी ये है कि आप जो है अगर बेस्ट असेसमेंट से बचना चाहते हैं तो यू हैव टू गो टू द हाई कोर्ट, यू हैव नो अदर ऑप्शन।
नहीं सर, लास्ट ईयर आई हैव ऑन सिमिलर फैक्ट 6 केसेस ऑफ वन पार्टी, फैक्ट इज से कॉमन, और इवन द हाई कोर्ट द सेम फैक्ट हैव ब्रॉट बिफोर द गुजरात हाई कोर्ट, दे हैव द जो एडवोकेट जिन्होंने फाइल किया था उन्होंने विथड्रॉ कर लिया था, बट आई हैव नॉट टेकन द विथड्रॉल दैट, और आई हैव ऑन द अदर काउंट, और नाउ द डिपार्टमेंट इज एग्री दैट, और दे हैव 3 नोटिस, दे हैव ड्रॉप इट आउट दैट, आई हैव नॉट कॉल्ड फॉर एनी रीजन।
No, I am telling you.
I am also challenging the decision of the GK and Drive Shaft. It is against the rule of law.
GK and Drive Shaft says, once you ask for the reason after filing the return, then only you will get.
Sir, 148 में कहीं पे भी नहीं लिखा हुआ कि file return of file of income.
सर आप देखो, टेक्निकली अगर किसी चीज को लड़ना चाहते हो तो बात अलग है, बट आई एम टेलिंग यू 99.9% मैंने अपनी लाइफ में अभी 35 साल में 4 या 5 केस देखे हैं जहां 148 ड्रॉप हुआ है।
सर मेरे लास्ट ईयर 3 ड्रॉप हुए थे एक ही पार्टी के केस में, और अभी मेरा पेटिशन है बिफोर ट्रिब्यूनल लास्ट 4 इयर्स से, दे हैव कांट रिप्लाई,
सो यू हैव टू फाइट इट,
रेफर कर रहे हैं।
मैं प्रैक्टिकल आदमी हूँ, इफ सपोज 5 लाख का इश्यू है, कितने पैसे खर्च करेगा सर, ट्रिब्यूनल जाएगा, हाई कोर्ट जाएगा, जमीन निकल जाएगा उसका?
नहीं सर, मैं चार्जिंग मेरी ट्रिब्यूनल तक की फीस चार्ज करता हूँ, मेरा वो नहीं है कि इसके मैं एक क्वांटम देता हूँ कि ट्रिब्यूनल तक मैटर जाएगा, और मैं उसी पे ही लड़ता हूँ।
इंडिविजुअल इशू है ना सर?
नहीं, इंडिविजुअल इशू नहीं है सर, कॉमन इशू, प्रोसीजर इज अ कॉमन।
नहीं वो ठीक है, ये इंडिविजुअल चॉइस है, यू वांट टू गो एंड प्रेफर द लिटिगेशन और यू वांट टू फिनिश द लिटिगेशन।
सर मेरे 700 केसेस है सीआईटी अपील में लास्ट 7 ईयर से, लेकिन अभी तो कोई भी सीआईटी अपील तक आंसर नहीं दे पाया, एडवोकेट नहीं कर पा रहा है,
तो फिर वो फंसे हुए हैं ना?
नहीं फंसे हुए नहीं है सर, वो उसमें फंसे, वो फंस गए हैं उसके अंदर में।
हाँ तो हो जाते। ये आपको बता दूं, पेनी स्टॉक और जो आपके सीसीएम थे, ये आपकी जितनी भी ट्रांसफर हुए या तो डे डिफरेंस वाले, वो सारे केसेस में एलिगेशन पूरे नहीं हो पाएंगे, तो ये क्लाइंट कोड मॉडिफिकेशन वाले सीसीएम, प्रीतम जी वो वाला हमारा सीसीएम वाला नहीं है, क्लाइंट कोड मॉडिफिकेशन वाला।
सुमित सर, यू मे टेक द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन प्लीज।
यस, आई एम एक्सीडिंग माय टाइम ऑलरेडी।
आई थिंक सो देयर आर 2 क्वेश्चंस लेफ्ट, सो वी विल जस्ट टेक इट अप एंड वी कैन स्टार्ट द नेक्स्ट सेशन।
हेलो हेलो सर, मैम आपने एक एग्जांपल के लिए पूछा था इन रिलेशन टू अ पेनल्टी, मेरा एग्जांपल ये है कि एक हाउस और एक हाउस प्रॉपर्टी सेल करी जिसपे जो था एसएससी ने 10 लाख रुपए कैश लिया, बट उसने जो अपनी इनकम डिक्लेयर करी बिल्कुल करेक्ट करी, क्या वो 10 लाख रुपए की कैश पेनल्टी लगा सकता है?
सर अगर आज के दिनों में है तो आप कैश रिसीव नहीं कर सकते, 2 लाख से ऊपर 269 एसटी लग जाएगा।
बिल्कुल सर।
और प्रॉपर्टी के केस में तो आप 20,000 से ऊपर नहीं रिसीव कर सकते।
बट अब इसका क्वेश्चन ये है कि आप असेसमेंट पीरियड तो निकल गया, बट 148 की खुल सकती है।
अरे सर बहुत सारे ये सारे डिपार्टमेंट ने पूरी की पूरी रजिस्ट्रार से सबका बंदर बनाया हुआ सर। एनीथिंग एल्स
सुमित सर? क्वेश्चन सुमित सर अनम्यूट कर लीजिए।
एक्चुअली ऑटोमेटिक अनम्यूट हो रहा है, वो कंट्रोल रूम कर दे रहा है आपका।
अंकित हो सकता है कि सबको म्यूट कर रहा हो, दैट इज द रीजन दैट वाइट इज पॉसिबल। सर देर इज वन मोर क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम सुमित सचदेव जी, वॉट इज द रेलिवेंट डेट फॉर इश्यूएंस ऑफ नोटिस अंडर सेक्शन 148 फॉर द असेसमेंट ईयर 13 and 14? सर मेजोरिटी ऑफ द कोर्ट्स बात कर जजमेंट्स आपने डिस्कस करी हैं, जस्ट अ स्नैपशॉट, जस्ट अ क्विक रिव्यू के 13-14 असेसमेंट ईयर की लास्ट डेट कब की है सर नोटिस इश्यू करने की 148 की?
अगर मुझसे सही पूछोगे तो 31-3-20 है, लेकिन बहुत सारे लोग 31-3-20-2020
सर 31 December 2020 नहीं, जो नया एक्ट आया जिसके अंदर बोला है,
मैं कह रहा हूं वो भी नहीं एक्सटेंड कर सकते। क्यों? रिलैक्सेशन के लिए है। इसमें डिपार्टमेंट को रिलैक्सेशन क्यों चाहिए? एसएससी को चाहिए रिलैक्सेशन, डिपार्टमेंट को किस बात की रिलैक्सेशन चाहिए? आपने तो घर से बैठ के नोटिस इश्यू करने थे, मेरे को तो आपके आना था, लेकिन दिसंबर मार्च तक के नोटिसेस मेरी ओपिनियन में जो है वो ज्यादा कंटेस्टेबल नहीं है। मार्च के बाद के नोटिसेस आर कंटेस्टेबल।
सर हमारे इसमें एक और व्यू है, December 2020 तक तो एक्ट में मेंशनड है, December 2020 के बाद की जो डेट एक्सटेंड करी है वो थ्रू अ नोटिफिकेशन कर रखी है, जो अलग अलग नोटिफिकेशन के तहत अलग अलग डेट्स इंक्रीज करी है, जो पहले मार्च 21 हुई थी फिर जून 21 हुई थी। सो जो December 2020 की डेट एक्सटेंड हुई है थ्रू एक्ट अमेंडेड एक्ट जो इंक्रीज हुई है, जहां पर वो बोलता है कि 20th मार्च 2020 के बाद जो भी पीरियड फॉल करता है जिसकी डेट एक्सटेंड करी थी 31 दिसंबर 2020 तक। सो मेरा पर्सनल ओपिनियन यह है कि वहां तक तो एक फॉल कर जाएगा अगर हमने नोटिसेस 31 दिसंबर तक इशू कर रखा है, दैट इज विद इन द फोर कॉर्नर्स ऑफ लॉ, मगर अगर उसके बात करें देन डेफिनेटली देयर इज अ चांस के वो निकल जाएगा केस।
सर ये तो अब देखना है ना, हमारे भाई साहब बता रहे थे 700 नोटिस हैं, तो अब आप कंटेस्ट कर सकते हो नहीं कर सकते? देखो ओरिजिनल तो 31 मार्च थी कोई भी चीज एक्सटेंड, अगर डिपार्टमेंट रिटर्न फाइलिंग थोड़ी है सर, ये असेसमेंट है, इशू ऑफ नोटिस है, दिस मे रिजल्ट टू द एसएससी That मैंने डिस्ट्रॉय कर दी बुक्स ऑफ अकाउंट, फिर वहां भी अमेंडमेंट करो, उसको भी एक्सटेंड करते।
बिल्कुल सर।
So, sir, these are contestable issues. I don't say that you should fight it out, but when you are dragged inside, then you can contest this point also. But 31st March 21, normally it should not challenge so way. After 31st March, yes, lot of courts have done.
So, sir, excellent session. The way you have explained the overlapping provisions with regard to Section 148, with regard to different periods, Section 148A, new section which was introduced, remarkable, sir. There are various comments coming to me personally, wherein you, where they have asked us for another session from your end with regard to the litigation management. So, we shall plan that session in the month of August when we talk about, sir. Thanks a lot. It is a pleasure to have you on our platform, sir. And the audience, if we see the audience, we have more than 400 participants as on date today, as currently. So that again, it's also a tremendous, sir, because it is only because of you, sir. Thanks a lot again from the team AFTP, sir, and team WebTel, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, boss. Rajiv bhai, can I take your leave? I'm having a concurrent session going on in Voice of CA. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thanks a lot to the AFTP.
Thank you, sir. So, friends, with this, let us come to the second topic of the today. That is the new and the old scheme of income tax and the changes in ITR with regard to assessment year 2021 and 2022. For elaborating on the same, we have CA Rajiv Khandelwal ji, who is from Viptel. When we talk about CA Rajiv Khandelwal ji, sir has already is having an experience of more than 25 years, and he is an alumni from SRCC. He has contributed to various e-learning modules of ICAI. He has also been awarded as an contribution in various faculties of NIRC. So without wasting much of time, I would like to directly invite CA Rajiv Khandelwal ji for deliberating upon the topic,
sir. Pritham sir, Ankit may have to unmute Rajiv sir.
Ankit, please unmute Rajiv ji.
And also make him the co-host. He lost the connection, so he has just joined again.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir. We are able to hear you. Sir.
Okay. Allow sharing to me also.
Ankit, please make Rajiv ji as co-host.
Sir, please try.
This must be
it is coming.
Enabled. Yes, yes. Perfectly fine, sir.
Yeah. So, very good evening to the participants, CA Pritham Goyal and other dignitaries. So I think we had a wonderful session from Sanjay Agarwal ji, and his explanation was very lucid regarding the reassessment proceedings, changes, etc., and comparison to the last scheme which was there. Now we'll talk about something much simpler, which is the choice of the scheme of ITR in new versus old. We'll be talking about various practical things and besides law also. So first thing, one important thing is that you are aware that last time the time limit was extended several times for making investments in PF, in other tax saving instruments, etc. So from the period from April to July 2020, the salaried person or the other persons had the option to either use it for financial year 1920 or 2021. So by mistake or intentionally, some people may try to take the benefit in both the years. So even so, we have to put some checks and balances in that. And even in the ITR forms, they had made the changes wherein they were asking separately for investments and deductions up to 31st of March and from April to July. Similarly, for capital gains exemptions, the investments, etc., made up 31st of March and from April to September. So we have, we as people who allow all these, I think now last year returns have been filed. Now we are talking about current year, financial year 21-22, which is going on. We have to be careful about that. I will also like to explain how things will happen. If some PPF deposit of 50,000 was made in March 2020, obviously the benefit will have to be taken in assessment year 2021 ITR. If some investment was made in August 2020 of 60,000 rupees, the benefit will be taken in assessment year 21-22. Now the question comes, when the investment has been done from April to July 2020 of let's say 1 lakh rupees, in that case, either I can claim an ITR for assessment year 2021 and not claim in assessment year 21-22, or vice versa. I can do either of these two things. But obviously, it should not be that I'm claiming in both the years. That should not be there. What about 30,000 and 70,000? Can I do that? Can I break up this amount of 1 lakh in 30,000 and 70,000? Can we get some responses on the chat?
Please comment in the chat box.
Can we break up this amount of 1 lakh rupees which we deposited between April to July 2000?
Sir, mixed response. Somebody's one is saying, no, one is yes, and
somebody's
so on.
Saying no. But the answer is no, you cannot do this. You cannot break up this amount. You either claim it in assessment year 2021 or assessment year 21-22. And it is also not necessary that investment should have been made from income of assessment year 2021 only to claim it in ITR of that year. Does it make any difference? This in earlier years, this provision was there that the investment should have been made out of the taxable income, but that provision has been done away with. Now let us take another case wherein these investments are different investments are made, and here as you can see that in financial year 1920 I'm claiming it 1 lakh rupees, and in option 2 I'm claiming it in the other year. So this option is available, and as I said, this breakup is not allowed. And for PPF and Sukanya Samriddhi account, splitting of amount in different financial years is not allowed. This has been clarified in the circular dated 11th April 2020. Now let us also see another thing. Coming to the dual income tax scheme, which is applicable from assessment year 21-22 or financial year 2021 onwards, it is applicable only to individuals and HUF. And here we have an option to pay taxes at lower rates under section 115 BAC. The normal rates, you are aware, for individuals and HUF up to 65 years, these are the normal rates, 5%, 20% and 30%. And in the new scheme of taxation, we have slabs of 2,50,000 each, and with an increase in rate of 5% each in the slab. And the highest slab is 30%, which is same in both the schemes. So in the new regime and in the old regime, up to 2.5 lakhs, there is no tax. From 2,50,000 to 5 lakhs, 5% tax is there. From 5 lakh to 10 lakhs, in the old regime, it was 20%. Whereas in the new regime, from 5 lakh to 7.5 lakhs, it is 10%. And 7.5 lakhs to 10 lakhs, it is 15%. And then beyond 15 lakhs, it is 30% in all the, both the cases. And from 10 lakhs to 15 lakhs, it is 30% in the old regime. And from 10 lakh to 12.5 lakhs, it's 20%. And from 12.5 lakhs to 15 lakhs, it is 25% in the new regime. And these are the difference in rates that you can see in both the schemes amount wise. And beyond 15 lakhs, there is no difference. The incremental tax remains the same. The surcharge, the education says, it remains the same in both the schemes. So we do not have to worry about that. We have to see the tax before surcharge and cess because they remain the same in both the cases. So in short, if we can say the old scheme was with higher rates with exemptions and deductions, whereas the new scheme is with low rates of income tax without exemptions and deductions. Now let us see in the new regime, what all allowances will not be allowed. Exemptions will not be allowed, practically all the allowances. We'll just see a few ones in where we will get the benefit, like house rent allowance, leave travel allowance, children education allowance, postal allowance, transport allowance, normal ones that we are accustomed to, or even others like uniform allowance, research allowance, tribal area allowance, hilly region allowance. All these allowances will be fully taxable. No exemptions in the new regime. Even the meal passes of Sodexo, etc. that you receive, they will be fully taxable in the new regime. Some allowances will be allowed, which are transport allowance given to a Divyang employee for commuting between residence and place of duty. Conveyance allowance only for official purposes. Conveyance allowance from residence to office and from office to residence, which was to an extent allowed, exemption was allowed in the earlier scheme of things. That's not allowed now. Only the conveyance allowance which is paid for official travel, that is allowed. Then travel allowance to meet the cost of travel on a tour or transfer, etc. Or daily allowance if you are posted outstation, etc. Only these are allowed. Then another drawback of the new scheme, that all these deductions like standard deduction, deduction for profession tax, deduction for entertainment allowance in the case of government employees, etc. All these are not allowed. And also other incomes like interest on house property, on self-occupied house property, vacant property, any loss thereof is not allowed here. Income is taxable, but if there is any loss from house property, whether self-occupied property or rented property, that loss cannot be set off against other heads of income and also obviously cannot be carried forward. Then in case of other income, family pension, no deduction under section 1557. subsection 2A shall be allowed. Only amount will be taxable. No deduction is allowed in the new regime. Whereas deduction is allowed in the earlier regime of taxation, you're aware. Then deduction under or exemption under section 10, subsection 32 for children, if their income is clubbed in the income of their parent, up to 1500 rupees per child was allowed earlier. That is not allowed in the new regime. In general, we can say no, all the general allowances that we are normally aware of or normally they get, no exemption is allowed. Coming to deductions, again, the general rule is no deduction is allowed. Whether it is for ATC, for payment of life insurance premium, PPF, PF, etc., or Mediclaim premium, ATP, DD, expenditure on medical treatment of disabled persons, etc., all these are not allowed. Interest on a loan for higher education, donations made by non-salaried person under section 80GG, all these are not allowed. Even normal deductions like ATTTA and ATTTB for savings bank interest in the case up to 10,000 in the case of normal individuals and up to 50,000 in the case of senior citizens from savings and interest, nothing is allowed in the new regime. But the employer contribution to notify pension under section 80CCD subsection 2, that is allowed in the new regime also. And thankfully, all the retirement benefits like exemption in respect of gratuity, leave and cashment, etc., there is no change. It was allowed in the old regime. It is allowed. Exemption is allowed in the new regime as well. And similarly, withdrawals are exempt still in the new regime, whether it is PPF, EPF, NPS, etc. So whatever the provisions are there, they stand. There's no change whether you opt for the old scheme or the new scheme. Now let us see these new regime changes vis-a-vis the Form 16 and the ITR form. If we see the Form 16, then allowance to the extent exempt under Section 10, nothing is allowed here. Very few allowances, as I just told you, but most of these allowances will be nil. And also entertainment allowance, tax on employment, standard deduction, all will be nil in the new regime. Loss from house property will not be allowed. All these deductions not allowed under the new regime. Relief under Section 87A and relief under 89, these are allowed in the old scheme as well as the new regime also. Relief under Section 87A for tax relief in the case of income up to 5 lakhs and under Section 89 in case you are receiving any advance or arrears of income. So the benefit of that by filing the relevant form, you can get that benefit. These are allowed in the old scheme as well as the new scheme. In ITR, if you see, first of all, you have to give in the ITR whether you are opting for the new regime under Section 115 BAC, yes or no. You have to answer that question. Thereafter, here allowances under Section 10 will be generally zero. Standard deduction, etc. will be zero. Loss under the house property will be zero. Deduction under Section 57, subsection 2A. In the case of family pension will be zero. All these deductions amount will be zero. But 87A relief and 89 relief will be available in both the regimes. Now, here I'll also like to tell you that this year there is a change, that there is some pre-filled information in ITR, which is to be taken from the department XML, and that is to be imported in the software that you are using. And the basis of that, it will be updated. If the name, PAN or date of birth is not matching in the PAN database, then an error will be thrown if you upload the return. So please ensure that, and this data is pre-filled from the PAN database, name, PAN and date of birth. This is pre-filled from the PAN database. Similarly, there are other fields like address, Aadhaar number, mobile number and the email ID. These are pre-filled, will be pre-filled in the ITR from the e-filing profile. Then also other things like type of house property and bank account details will be there from the last ITR. or the bank account details in the case of the assessee from the e-filing profile. All these will be pre-filled, whether you are making return from the department portal or from an offline software like WebiTax or WebTel. So all these have to be pre-filled. And also the salary details, because now the Form 24Q last date has of Q4 has already elapsed, and the employees, most of the employees have filed the 24Q. Now in due course, even these details like details of salary, income and allowances, details of deductions, tax relief under Section 89, they will be pre-filled from 24Q that your employer has filed. Also, from 26A, some information will be updated, like tax payment, TDS, TCS, income from house property, and interest on fixed deposits. All this information will be pre-filled in the ITR from 26A. And also, from PAN login will come the verification details, that is the self or representative PAN. All these things should match with the data which I'm telling you, either 26A or the PAN login. If that does not match, probably when you file the ITR, an error will be thrown. So please be careful that this information. So in WebiTax, we have given this option also of updating, and we will. I'll just show you if time permits. Side by side, we are showing the data as per the WebiTax software that you have punched in already in the masters, and the data which has been fetched from the department, and you can make the relevant changes. And also the bank account details will have to be pre-validated. And if that is not done, refund will not be transferred to the bank account. So these are some new things which you have to be careful about while filing ITRs for this year. Otherwise, if you wake up at the last moment or you ask this information at the last moment from the assessee, then probably delays will be there and problems will be there. So please, before starting filing the ITRs, start doing all these things that I'm telling you, updating the masters with the department database that I'm telling you, pre-validating the bank accounts, because at least one bank account must be pre-validated. So otherwise the refund will not be sent. So that's very important. So now let us talk about the business assessees. We've just now seen what will happen in the case of salaried persons. What about business assessees? Because business assessees can also opt for, if they are individuals in nature, they can also opt for the new regime. In the case of the business assessees also, many deductions and exemptions will not be allowed, like additional depreciation, exemption to SEZ unit, deduction for relevant industries like tea, coffee, rubber, development account, deduction for notified areas, etc. Will not be allowed. Depreciation under Section 32, normal depreciation, that will be allowed. And deductions under Section 35 for scientific research, 35AD, 35CC, etc., etc., will not be allowed in the new regime. And also, no set-off of losses or depreciation will be allowed if it is due to any of the specified deductions which are not allowed. If earlier any loss is there, and it is due to these specified deductions which are not allowed in the new regime, so that benefit also, the loss for set off will also not be allowed. But the deduction under Section 80JJAA for new employment that is allowed in the old regime, that will also be allowed in the new regime. This is available. And in the ITR, if you want to see ITR forms, all these deductions will not be allowed. And obviously, in the case of business assessee who is also a salaried person, all these deductions. This is a flip side, that if you go for the new regime with a lower taxation, some benefits which you automatically get, because if the PF deduction is there, you don't have to contribute anything extra. That is statutory, and it will be deducted. Or profession taxes being deducted on a statutory basis. You don't have any choice whether you are going for the new regime or the old regime. And standard deduction, we are getting a deduction, as the name suggests, it's a standard deduction available to all the employees, but not if you go for the new regime. We miss out on that without even making any additional contribution. We get this benefit in the old regime, but it is not available in the new regime. And this intimation is to be given by the employee at the start of the year. and whether he'll go for the new regime or the old regime. So for the current financial year also, by now you must have taken an intimation from him which scheme he wants to go for, whether the old scheme or the new regime. And when we file the ITR, already the 24Q for financial year 2021 have been filed, because 15 July was the extended last date. Here in the 24Q, last quarter, you have given this information on the basis of intimation received from the employee, whether the employee is opting for the old scheme or the new scheme. On the basis of this information that is gone in 24Q, will the information be updated in Form 16, whether you are opting for the new scheme of taxation under Section 115 BAC? So when you receive a Form 16, if you have not already received, this additional row will be there, wherein the old scheme or the new scheme will be visible, which scheme you have opted for. But many employees do not tell you, because they are just in the thinking mode. They may be asking their friends, they may be asking their relatives, they may be searching the internet as to which scheme is beneficial. So वो आपको बताते ही नहीं है. तो कोई बात नहीं, अगर नहीं भी बताते तो या तो old scheme intimate करेंगे या new scheme intimate करेंगे. कोई भी intimate नहीं करेंगे तो you can presume that it is the old scheme. And वैसे भी for income up to 5 lakhs, there is no need to select a scheme. वहाँ दोनों केसेस में आपकी इनकम टैक्स नहीं होता है ड्यू टू रिबेट अंडर सेक्शन 87A, सो डजंट मेक अ डिफरेंस इफ दे आर नॉट गिविंग यू दैट. यू कैन गो फॉर द न्यू रेजिम, बिकॉज़ इन दैट केस यू डोंट हैव टू आस्क फॉर एनी इन्वेस्टमेंट प्रूफ्स एटसेट्रा. सो द आईटी डिक्लेरेशन एंड द इन्वेस्टमेंट प्रूफ्स आर रिक्वायर्ड ओनली फॉर द ओल्ड स्कीम. नो चेंज ऑफ स्कीम ऑफ टीडीएस वंस इंटीमेटेड. Once the employee has intimated to you the choice of the scheme, continue deducting TDS on the basis of that. No change of scheme is allowed during the financial year. But ये तो बड़ा touchy वाला, बड़ा sentimental वाला मामला है, क्योंकि अगर उसने old scheme बता दिया और आगे किसी ने उसको बता दिया कि भाई new scheme beneficial था और उसका TDS ज़्यादा कट रहा है, तो एक रुपया भी अगर ज़्यादा कटता है तो दिल को बड़ी तकलीफ होती है. टैक्स सरकार को देने में लोगों को बहुत तकलीफ होती है और सैलरीड पर्सन्स को रियली ज्यादा तकलीफ होती है, क्योंकि वो कोई एक्सपेंसेस वगैरह क्लेम नहीं कर पाते. सो ऑब्वियसली इन मेनी केसेस दे विल कम बैक टू यू, आई वांट टू चेंज द स्कीम एक्सेट्रा. सो यू कैन टेल देम दैट यू डोंट नीड टू वरी, बिकॉज द चेंज ऑफ स्कीम इज अलाउड एट द टाइम ऑफ फाइलिंग द ITR. डजंट मैटर इफ सम एक्स्ट्रा टैक्सेस डिडक्टेड एस टीडीएस ड्यूरिंग द ईयर, यू कैन change the scheme while filing the ITR. And agar aapka kuch refund hoga to department refund de dega. Department bahut acha hai, bada timely aajkal refund issue kar deta hai, to chinta ki koi baat nahi hai, refund aapko mil jayega. Aur refund jab department ki taraf se aata hai to bada acha lagta hai. Tax jama karte hue jitni takleef hoti hai, aur department se agar refund aa jata hai, jo aajkal kafi fast aur prompt aa jata hai most cases mein, to aur acha lagta hai. Lagta hai jaise kuch additional income hui hai. So you can guide him that way. Now let us see what the section 115 BAC, jiske baare mein hum baar baar baat kar rahe hain, wo kya kehta hai. Nothing contained in this section shall apply unless option is exercised in the prescribed manner by the person. So aapko ye option exercise karni padegi choice of scheme ke liye. Having income from business or professional on or before the due date specified in the subsection 1 of section 139. For furnishing the returns of income for any previous year relevant to the assessment year commencing on the first day of April 2021, and such option once exercised shall apply to subsequent assessment years. So business wale hain, unke liye ye option ek bar select kar lenge to aage change nahi kar payenge. Jo dusre wale hain, other than the business income wale, salaried persons or income from other sources etc wale, they have to select this option while filing the ITR. Under section 139 subsection 1, तो ये business and non-business cases के लिए 115 BAC clearly spell out करता है. इसका मतलब क्या है? Business persons के लिए they have to file form 10IE for choice of the scheme, and this has to be filed by the due date of filing the ITR. Non-business assessees हैं जो चाहे salaried हैं, चाहे rental income वाले या इंटरेस्ट ऑन बैंक डिपॉजिट्स एक्सेट्रा, इनकम फ्रॉम अदर सोर्सेस, they can choose the scheme while filing the ITR. This form 10IE, this is the physical form, but this form is to be also to be electronically filed at the department portal. जब आप पोर्टल पे जाके देखेंगे तो वहाँ डिफरेंट फॉर्म्स में नॉन आईटीआर फॉर्म्स में दिस फॉर्म इज देयर यू कैन गो एंड फिल दिस फॉर्म एंड प्लीज फिल इट बाय द ड्यू डेट और द एक्सटेंडेड ड्यू डेट अदरवाइज आपकी पुरानी स्कीम ही चलेगी न्यू स्कीम आप ऑप्ट नहीं कर पाएंगे अगर आप ड्यू डेट तक इस फॉर्म को फाइल नहीं करते सो दिस ऑप्शन इज टू बी एक्सरसाइज्ड ओनली टिल ड्यू डेट ऑफ फाइलिंग द आईटीआर एंड इट्स ऑल्सो इम्पोर्टेंट सो एटलीस्ट आप ऑप्शन ये एक्सरसाइज कर लें और क्योंकि नॉन बिजनेस केसेस में तो ये आईटीआर फाइल करते ही टाइम ही आप ऑप्शन एक्सरसाइज कर सकते हैं आई विल रिपीट दैट फॉर बिजनेस केसेस यू हैव टू फाइल फॉर्म 10IE व्हिच मस्ट बी फाइल्ड टिल ड्यू डेट सो दैट ऑप्शन इज एक्सरसाइज बट फॉर नॉन बिजनेस केसेस दिस ऑप्शन इज टू बी एक्सरसाइज इन द आईटीआर इटसेल्फ So it is important that you file the ITR by the due date. If you do not file by the due date, you lose this choice option and you'll have to go for the old scheme itself. You cannot afford the new scheme in belated return. So ye aapko dhyan rakhna hai, due date tak file karna hai. Otherwise, old scheme mein agar aap karna chahte hain, koi baat nahi. New scheme wale dhyan rakh lijiye ki ITR ko due date tak hi file karna. Because this option is not available in the case of belated return. और business वालों को खास ध्यान रखना है क्योंकि जो non-business persons हैं, they can choose the scheme every year. कोई दिक्कत नहीं है एक साल आप old कर लीजिए अगले साल new कर लीजिए फिर old कर लीजिए फिर new कर लीजिए जैसा आपका मन है जैसी आपकी income है उसके हिसाब से आप choice of scheme आप exercise कर सकते हैं डिपार्टमेंट ने यह पूरी आपको बेनिफिट दिया है पूरा आपको इजाजत दी है उसके लिए बट बिजनेस एसएससीज थोड़ा सा ज्यादा कॉम्प्लिकेटेड होता है शायद और वो कॉम्प्लिकेशन डिपार्टमेंट नहीं चाहता था दैट इज व्हाई दे हैव अलाउड यू दैट यू कैन नॉट मेक दिस चेंज ऑफ स्कीम एवरी ईयर वंस दिस हैज बीन एक्सरसाइज्ड और अगर आपने ड्यू डेट तक ये एक्सरसाइज नहीं करी फर्स्ट ईयर में तो आगे के सब सालों के लिए आपकी ओल्ड रिजीम ही चलेगी बिजनेस एसएससीज की न्यू रिजीम उनकी नहीं चलेगी इस बात का आपको ध्यान रखना है बिजनेस एसएससीज को और भी ज्यादा ध्यान रखना है क्योंकि एक बार बाय डिफॉल्ट या आपके एक्सरसाइज करने से ओल्ड रिजीम आपने सेलेक्ट कर ली ओल्ड रिजीम विल कंटिन्यू ओनली वंस इन योर लाइफ टाइम विल यू बी एबल टू चेंज द स्कीम उसके अलावा चेंज नहीं करना चाहेंगे ऑब्वियसली अगर बिजनेस ही आपने छोड़ दिया बंद कर दिया आप सैलरीड हो गए या आपकी अदर सोर्सेज की इनकम है वो तो बात ही दूसरी हो जाएगी वो तो हर साल आप ऑप्शन चेंज कर पाएंगे बट इफ यू आर अ बिजनेस एसएससी ओनली वंस इन द लाइफ टाइम यू कैन चेंज द स्कीम अदरवाइज यू कैन नॉट चेंज द स्कीम सो वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू फाइल दिस फॉर्म 10I इन बाय द ड्यू डेट एक और प्रैक्टिकल प्रॉब्लम आती है कि एम्प्लॉयर आप आजकल काफी जॉब स्विच करते रहते हैं आप एक जॉब छोड़ के दूसरी जॉब कर ली दो से तीसरी कर ली इन द सेम फाइनेंशियल ईयर तो उस केस में अगर फर्स्ट एम्प्लॉयर का आपने ओल्ड स्कीम का बता दिया तो सेकंड एम्प्लॉयर के केस में कौन सी स्कीम क्या वो न्यू स्कीम पे जा सकता है चैट बॉक्स पे जरा थोड़ा सा रिप्लाई करिए आप प्लीज वेदर इफ टू द एम्प्लॉयर वन ही हैज सबमिटेड द ओल्ड स्कीम कैन ही चूज द न्यू स्कीम विद द न्यू एम्प्लॉयर yes or no I think mere responses aa rahe hain iske upar but I think kyunki department ne kaha hai aap ek hi baar choose kar sakte hain so it is if we go by the rule book so old scheme agar pehli baar select kari hai to second employer third employer mein bhi old scheme hi chalni chahiye so this is agar department ko clarity dega is bare mein to it will be better but as things stand now it seems that once the choice has been made it should not be changed बट अगर एम्प्लॉय जैसे मैंने कहा बड़ा टची वाला इशू होता है बड़ा सेंटिमेंटल वाला इशू होता है और कुछ लोग तो बिल्कुल लड़ने पे आ जाते हैं ये बहुत साल पहले मैंने ये सब काम किया हुआ है इसलिए मुझे पता है वो एचओडीज आ जाते हैं और पता नहीं क्या क्या डिस्कशंस और इतने डिबेट्स हो जाते हैं हीटेड आर्गुमेंट्स हो जाती है तो एक प्रैक्टिकल सोल्यूशन मैं आपको दे सकता हूँ डजंट मेक अ डिफरेंस अगर पिछले साल की तो रिटर्न फाइल हो चुकी वो तो किस्सा क्लोज हो गया जो हम फाइनेंशियल ईयर 2021 की बात कर रहे हैं उसकी तो आपने 24Q इन मोस्ट ऑफ द केसेस हैव बीन फाइल्ड, जिनकी भी रिलेटेड है वो अभी सोच सकते हैं उसके बारे में, चेंज कर सकते हैं. बट इफ 24Q हैज बीन फाइल्ड और उसने वहां ओल्ड रिजीम सेलेक्ट करी थी, अब वो न्यू रिजीम चाहता है, ITR फाइल करते टाइम चेंज कर ले भाई, कोई मना नहीं कर रहा आपको, कर लीजिए. बट कमिंग टू द करंट ईयर और एनी सब्सिक्वेंट ईयर, एज यू हैव सीन दिस इंफॉर्मेशन गोस टू डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ चॉइस ऑफ स्कीम ओनली इन Q4 24Q. फर्स्ट क्वार्टर, सेकेंड क्वार्टर, थर्ड क्वार्टर में ये कोई इन्फॉर्मेशन नहीं जाते. जब जाती नहीं है तो अगर बेचारा चेंज करना चाह रहा है और कोई बहुत टैक्स के में कोई डिफरेंस नहीं आ रहा, और नॉर्मली वैसे भी आप TDS का अमाउंट तो चेंज करते रहते हैं सारे साल में, सही वाला जो होता है वो मार्च में जाके डिडक्ट होता है. एम आई राइट? ये जरा चैट बॉक्स पे ये भी बता दो. फाइनल वाला TDS जो होता है, सही वाला होता है, वो तो मार्च में जाके पता लगता है, तब तक तो किससे कहानियां सब कुछ चलते रहते हैं, राइट? सो फोर्थ क्वार्टर में ये इन्फॉर्मेशन जानी है, तो अगर बेचारा बहुत तंग कर रहा है आपको, बहुत पीछे पड़ रहा है और हीटेड आर्ग्यूमेंट हो रहे हैं, चेंज कर दीजिए स्कीम 24Q फाइल करते टाइम उसकी, और आप अपने डिडक्शन के लिए TDS के लिए उसकी स्कीम ओल्ड पहले कही थी तो एक आध महीने कट गया, डजंट मेक अ डिफरेंस, न्यू स्कीम से काटना चालू कर दीजिए. एंड व्हेन यू फाइल द Q4 रिटर्न, बाउंस का आप न्यू स्कीम का दे दीजिए और वही से बरसा. So I think practically we can do that, no issues with that. But अगर आप बहुत strict हैं और आप कहते हैं भाई law जो कहता है वही करना है, तो फिर आप मत change करने दीजिए और ITR की time पे वो change कर सकते. ये summarize कर दिया मैंने जो अभी तक आपको बताया. Business assessees हैं, they are allowed to change only once in the subsequent years, and the choice of scheme is to be made in by filing form from 10IE. नॉन-बिजनेस असेसेस के लिए जो ITR फॉर्म होता है उसमें उनको करना होता है, और हर साल वो चेंज कर सकते हैं. हर साल वो अपना जो एम्प्लॉयर है उसको हर साल बता सकते हैं कि दिस इज माय स्कीम फॉर दिस ईयर. दैट इज व्हाई एवरी ईयर इन द डिक्लेरेशन यू हैव टू टेक. बल्कि डिक्लेरेशन में आप ये भी उससे जो है उसमें आप पूछ सकते हैं कि लास्ट ईयर आपने ये किया था, और अगर आप चेंज नहीं करेंगे तो हम प्रिज्यूम करेंगे वो सेम चलेगा. ये दीज थिंग्स आर द प्रैक्टिकल थिंग्स दैट यू कैन take care of yourselves जब आप उसे declaration लेंगे at the beginning of the year. But उसने जो भी select किया वो ITR के time पे change कर सकता है. So we can now conclude with all these things that we've discussed. The people with own house will be benefit in the new regime due to lower rates, क्योंकि अभी उनका HRA होता है वो पूरा taxable होता है. Then people who are not making various tax saving investments will find the new scheme generally beneficial, क्योंकि वो investment नहीं कर रहे तो उनका जो taxable income है वो तो high रहेगा, तो lower rate से उनको benefit मिलेगा. Also entry level employees with lesser incomes will benefit in the new regime, because उनका income का level है वो lower है. अभी शुरू में income level कम ही होता है, धीरे धीरे income जब बढ़ती है तो obviously rate of taxation अगर कम income है तो lower rates of taxation है तो वो beneficial होगा. retirement benefits का चिंता करने की कोई जरूरत नहीं है, because ये दोनों regime में same होता है. loss from house property आपको forego करना पड़ेगा अगर आप new regime में जा रहे हैं. rebate under section 87A for income up to 5 lakhs दोनों scheme में available है, कोई चिंता करने की बात नहीं है. and profession tax and standard deduction दोनों scheme में allowed नहीं है, सिर्फ old regime में allowed है. So we have to be careful about that. So let us see at different levels how things will happen. Up to 5 lakhs, new and the old scheme, nil tax is there. On 6 lakhs of income, new and old regime, the tax is exactly the same, 23,400. Other cases, mein, if there are tax savings, it is better to go for the old regime. And if there are no tax savings or little tax savings, so new scheme may be beneficial. Now at different levels, let us see how things will happen. Let's say there is an income of 7 lakhs and tax under the new regime is 33,800 and the old regime is 44,200. So yahan gap hai hamara taxation mein, aur ho sakta hai ki aap old regime mein jana chahte hain kyunki aapki already tax savings hain, lekin tax aap new regime ka dena chahte hain. To is case mein aapko additional investment 50,000 ki karni padegi taki dono schemes mein aapka taxation same ho. इसी तरह से द इनकम इज 10 लाख एंड इनकम टैक्स ऑन इन द न्यू रिजीम इज 78,000 एंड इन द ओल्ड रिजीम इट इज 1,06,600. हियर इफ यू मेक एन एडिशनल इन्वेस्टमेंट ऑफ 1,37,500 द taxation in both the schemes will be the same. Similarly, if in, on an income level of 15 lakhs, the tax under the new regime is 1,95,000 and old regime for 2,57,400. On an additional investment of 2 lakh rupees, the tax will be the same in both the schemes. Now also see investments versus no investments. Let us take a case where the gross income is 18 lakhs. Standard deduction in the new regime will get the benefit of 50,000. Chapter 6A deductions of 2 lakh 12,000 something. Taxable old will be 15,37,000. Taxable new will be 18 lakhs. Income tax old will be 2,84,000 and income tax new will be 2,88,600. So beneficial will be 2,84,000. That is the old regime. But we take another case where no investments are made by this person. And in this case, as you can see, the new scheme will be beneficial because here the tax is 2,88,600, whereas in the old scheme it is 3,51,000. Let us take a case with PPF in the old regime and the new regime. What will happen in the with PPF standard deduction benefit in the old regime will get, and PF is there 21,600. PPF is 1,28,400. Here the income tax will come to 62,069 rupees. Whereas in the new regime, we'll not get these benefits of standard deduction, PF, PPF, etc. So the tax will be 69,235. So a benefit of 7,166 in the old regime. Without PPF, the old regime and the new regime, also you can see the difference on an income, a similar income. And if PPF is not there, other deductions, etc. are there. PPF is not there. In that case, the taxable salary will be 8,64,000 in the old regime and 9,43,000 in the new regime. And obviously, the new scheme will be beneficial by 19,541. So each case we have to see separately. A general rule, thumb rule, we can say. But in general, aapko ek ek case mein dekhna padega. And obviously, because you cannot check for each scheme manually, that is why WebbyTax will help you in that. WebbyTax or WebbyTDS software will help you in understanding for each employee to the nearest rupee, the benefit or otherwise will be shown to you. Then also we can go further. We can also see the effective yield in both the cases. Ki agar PPF mein humne invest kiya hota, to kya hamara benefit hota, kitna yield hota? FD mein invest kiya hota, kitna yield hota? To wo bhi hum ek further step mein jaake wo bhi dekh sakte hain for finding out the overall benefit from the point of view of the assessee or the employee. So that was about the scheme. Now, I think we'll take up the question answers at the end. Thoda sa practical dekh lete hain ki kaise softwares ko use karke hum uska benefit le sakte hain. Let us see that now. First of all, during the year, we have to deduct TDS. Last year mein 2021 mein aapne deduct kiya hoga aur bahut issues aaye honge ki old regime new regime kaun sa beneficial hai ek ek employee ke liye dekhna. So it is the duty of the employee to tell you ki mere ko kaun sa scheme opt karna hai, but I think practically they are dependent on you unless and until they have some CA friend or relative jisse wo malum kar lete hain. Otherwise, as the taxation department or the accounts department, they're dependent on you ki aap bataiye hum kaun si scheme opt kare, hame to pata hi nahi hai. So that kind of thing is there. Let me show you in the software now. This is the WebbyTDS software. And during the year, like the financial year 21-22 that is running, we can punch in the salaries of the different employees like this. I already punched some data for some employees. And here we can see. I think the year is, this is for the current year. I have not punched data. I'll show you for the last year. We select the company here and the year from here. 2022 has been selected. Let me select 2021 for which data is already there. And here, let me share again. This sharing is stopped. This is the TDS software. Now let me go to the one employee. And here the various incomes are coming. And here the schemes under the taxation under both the schemes, as per old scheme and as per new regime, it is showing the tax. And by default, it is calculating and deducting tax as per the beneficial scheme. Above computation has been prepared considering exemptions and deductions as this is more beneficial. Now let us take another case of next employee. So for each employee, after filling in the data, we can see in this case, it is being calculated as per the old regime because that is beneficial. Let us take for another employee. So for each employee, we can see which scheme is beneficial. And if for some reason he wants to change the scheme, the option is there. You can change it from old to new and new to old, because sometimes some employees may be adamant, no, I want to go for the other scheme. It may be beneficial and all those kind of things. So it is telling you which scheme is beneficial. So here tax due is 33,800 in the old regime and 28,600 in the new regime. So obviously it is being deducted as per the new regime because that is beneficial. For each case, you can get the benefit here. You can see for each employee and accordingly, you can also advise. So it's not only for filing the TDS returns. It is also as an advisor to the employees for their well-being. Unhe achha lagega agar aap unko help karenge choice of scheme wagera mein. Otherwise, वो सब issues आते हैं, so obviously that will help them. Another important thing I wanted to share with you, let me share. Current year में एक और नया change आया है, as you are aware, कि higher rate पे TDS deduct करना है. Topic से related नहीं है, लेकिन इतना important है, so I think I should show you that also. Time permitting me that, so I'll just try and show you that. काफी दिक्कत आ रही है और काफी लोग परेशान थे कि विच स्कीम ऑफ हाउ वी शुड नो वुड नो दैट वेदर इज द स्पेसिफाइड पर्सन एंड हायर टीडीएस इज टू बी डिडक्टेड इन दिस केस और नॉट. सो काफी प्रॉब्लम हो रही थी, तो वो प्रॉब्लम हमने आपकी बिल्कुल आसान कर दी है. हमने आपको यहाँ फैसिलिटी दी है, यहाँ आप मास्टर्स में जाएंगे और पार्टी मास्टर में जाएंगे, या बल्कि हम सीधा सीधा जाते हैं ना. यहाँ हमने आपको स्क्रीन पर भी ऑप्शन दे दिया है, फाइल एटीआर फाइलिंग स्टेटस. यहाँ पे हम जाएंगे और ये लिस्ट आ जाएगी हमारी पार्टीज की, जो भी हमारे टीडीएस सॉफ्टवेयर में पार्टीज होंगी. और यहाँ पे हमने वेरीफाइड का, मैंने ऑलरेडी जो वेरीफाई कर रखे हैं वो यहाँ आ रहे हैं कि ये जो हायर टीडीएस है एप्लीकेबल है या नहीं, उनका पैन आधार स्टेटस क्या है, पैन अलॉटमेंट डेट क्या है एंड अपडेटेड डेट क्या है. This I've already done for the pending ones. Let me do once for you. Let us see इस time अगर net वगैरह ठीक से चल रहा है, तो मैं कुछ cases के और verify कर लेता हूँ आपके सामने. It is that simple. और obviously हम select all or select first 500 records करके इसको एक साथ भी कर सकते हैं. Get status and यहाँ एक बार capture डाल के आपके ये एक क्लिक ऑफ अ बटन पे आपके सारे आपके स्टेटस आ जाएगा. आपको पता लग जाएगा कौन से वो केसेस हैं जो लास्ट टू इयर्स के आईटीआर फाइल नहीं करें और उनका हायर रेट पे टीडीएस या टीसीएस एप्लीकेबल है. सो वी विल नो दैट. यहां कैप्चर डाल देते हैं. वंस ओनली यू हैव टू डू दैट. आई विल सबमिट इट and thoda sa intezar karna padega. We'll have to wait a little while if the data is too much. But since I've done only for it says invalid captcha. Ye kabhi kabhi invalid captcha ka error bhi aa jata hai. Let me try it once again. Kai bar refresh nahi ho pata captcha. That is why we get this error. Hopefully this will be done now. Verified successfully, and when we go to the verified section, these parties, it will be verifying whether he's a specified person and TDS and TCS higher rate is applicable or not. So that simple. काफी आपको problem हो रही होगी, even from a company level हमें भी दिक्कत आ रही थी कि कैसे करें. So we have given this wonderful solution thanks to our software team who has done this wonderful work. At the click of a button, you can do for all the parties, and बाद में जो जो add होते रहेंगे उनका आप कर सकते हैं. So that was besides the discussion that we are having, but still it was important. So मैंने आपके साथ share किया. अब हम चलते हैं ITR filing की तरफ. Please keep on admitting the persons because otherwise I have to do that. That's coming on my screen. So now let's go to the tax software, WebiTax software, and here also I've opened a. One of the assessees for which I'm filing the ITR. Here also we are side by side. We are getting the data of the current year and the previous year, so that if there are many major mismatches, we should be aware ki galti to nahi kar rahe hum koi. We are not making any mistakes because a lot of difference is coming in the various heads of income or in the tax amount, etc. So side by side we can compare, and also here. It is automatically calculating tax as per the scheme which is beneficial. एक-एक केस में आपको जाके नहीं चेक करना कि कौन सी स्कीम बेनिफिशियल है. ऑटोमेटिकली WebiTax सॉफ्टवेयर जो हमारा है वो ऑटोमेटिकली कैलकुलेट कर रहा है कि कौन सी स्कीम आपके लिए बेनिफिशियल है और उसके हिसाब से आपके लिए टैक्स कैलकुलेट करके बता रहा है. एंड इट इज एट द टॉप इट इज शोइंग यू टैक्स एज पर द ओल्ड रिजीम और द न्यू रिजीम एज द केस में भी वो आपको क्लियरली यहाँ से पता लग रहा है. एंड नीचे आपको डिफरेंस पता लग रहा है कि न्यू रिजीम में टैक्स और इंटरेस्ट मिला के कितना अमाउंट है एंड ओल्ड रिजीम में कितना है. और यहाँ भी अगर फॉर एनी रीजन द असेसी सेज और व्हाटएवर ही मे बी एडमिंट कि नो आई वांट टू गो फॉर द अदर रिजीम, सो यू कैन आल्सो चेंज टू द अदर रिजीम, चेंज टू न्यू रिजीम इवन दो द ओल्ड रिजीम इज बेनिफिशियल, इवन दैट चेंज इज अलाउड. अदरवाइज ऑब्वियसली जो भी बेनिफिशियल है वो तो आपका ऑटोमेटिकली कैलकुलेट होकर आएगा फॉर ईच एंड एवरी एम्प्लॉय. For each and every assessee that you are working as a practicing CA, so that way, ये आपके लिए बहुत beneficial है. और एक-एक केस में आपको खुद calculate करने की ज़रूरत नहीं है. You are getting this benefit. You just punch in the data. This calculation, all this calculation kind of calculation will be done for you by the software. So I think I've covered most of the things that I was expected to cover. Now, Shubham, we can take the queries.
Yes, sir. Sir, two of the participants wants to know whether the share data relating to capital gains will be pre-filled or not.
Basically, that information because the first the special information report the 61A etc. needs to be filed by the companies. Then only this data or the stock exchanges etc. they have to file this information in form 61A etc. statement of financial transactions. They have to file that. Only then it'll be available because that date is also being extended several times. So probably this year by the due date, I'm not sure whether this data will be auto populated or not. But at least next year onwards, it will be done. Or if you are filing the return and the date is again extended several times. So the possibility is that we'll get this data even this year, but we are not very sure about the authenticity of the data because it has so many complications. Let us see what kind of data comes. So I think this year you stick to your own data, and if the data is coming from the department, we can compare it and then file the return.
Okay, sir. There is a query from Surinder ji. One employee has opted for the new regime, but later he wants to opt for he wants to claim HRA deduction. So is that possible?
he wants to change the scheme?
He wants to change the scheme.
Yeah, that I said, theoretically, that is not allowed once he has exercised the scheme. But practically, since this information will be only going in the fourth quarter, 24Q, so you can change the scheme. Or if you do not want to do that, you can advise him that while filing the ITR, he can claim HRA and go for the old regime. No one stops you from doing that.
Sure. There is one query regarding house property. So whether the 30% deduction is allowed or not?
That is allowed. No change in that. The way income from house property is being calculated, that will remain the same. And if there is a positive income, that will be added to your income for calculating the tax table thereon. But if there is any loss from house property, that will only be not allowed. Otherwise, the deductions, etc., house property, house tax that you've paid, all that will be allowed as it was allowed earlier.
Sure, sir. I can see only there is one more regarding, they want to ask regarding professionals, whether they can adopt new scheme.
Yes, they can adopt the new scheme, business SSC and the professionals, they can offer the new regime or the old regime, but they will have to continue with that for the continuing years. They will have to continue with that for the all the subsequent years. Only once in their lifetime they can change, unless and until there is change in law or you stop the business and profession and you start having income from house property or salary or rental income, etc. In that case, you stop the business or the profession. Otherwise, this choice, I think it is like marriage. In most of the cases, you can only choose once. Thereafter, you cannot choose again. In general.
Okay, sir.
It's like the common people like us, not like film stars. Okay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sunil ji is asking, is interest on self-occupied property allowed? I think that you answered.
Yeah, bhi maine bataya na, it is not allowed. सेल्फ ऑक्यूपाइड प्रॉपर्टी में तो कोई आपकी इनकम होती नहीं है, सिर्फ आपका जो इंटरेस्ट होता है वही लॉस होता है और कोई बेनिफिट आपको मिलता नहीं है, सो दैट इज नॉट अलाउड.
संजय जी इज आस्किंग रिगार्डिंग व्हाट अबाउट एग्जेम्प्ट इनकम लाइक पीपीएफ इंटरेस्ट, दैट इज आल्सो नॉट टैक्सेबल.
पीपीएफ इंटरेस्ट वगैरह, देखिए एक तो आई विल रिक्वेस्ट यू नॉट टू आस्क सच क्वेश्चंस और ऐसे आइडियाज मत दीजिए. गवर्नमेंट वाले हमारे वाले इस तरह के वेमिनार्स में भी आ जाते हैं और ऐसी बातें सुन के वो अगली बार जब बजट आएगा तो ये आ जाएगा कि वो भी उसका बेनिफिट भी मिलेगा. तो प्लीज ऐसे सवाल अलग से पूछ लीजिए, ऐसे वेमिनार्स में प्लीज मत पूछिए. यस,
आई थिंक आई हैव कवर्ड द क्वेश्चंस पोस्टेड इन चैट बॉक्स. इफ देयर आर एनी क्वेरीज, इफ एनी पार्टिसिपेंट्स वांट टू आस्क एनी क्वेरी, दे कैन रेज हैंड्स.
वो भी कर सकते हैं और अनम्यूट भी कर सकते हैं.
If somebody participants wants to ask any query, can raise their hands. We'll unmute them.
234C वगैरह का आपको पता है, आजकल जब extension होती है, तो वो एक कहीं ना कहीं limit लगा देते हैं कि 1 lakh तक का जो आपका tax है, तब तक को आपको benefit मिलेगा और बाकी के लिए नहीं मिलेगा. तो वो सब आपको एक बार जो latest इस बार का आया हुआ है, वो आप check कर सकते हैं.
Business income, one
Rupesh is asking, in 1 year I'm showing commission income as business income and second year I show it as other source and change the scheme. Department wale aapke piche pad jayenge. Kabhi aap kehte hain business income hai, kabhi kuch karte hain, to aapko problem ho sakti hai. To aise kaam mat kariye please. Yes, if positive property income is there, rental income hai aapki, uske against aap interest ka benefit le sakte hain, no issues with that.
We are done with some questions, I suppose.
Again, I think for the last 2, 3, or 5 minutes, we can see if any more questions are there. Otherwise, we can wind up.
So, if anyone has any query left, though Rajiv sir's presentation has already discussed all the points and we have through a practical example, you have seen how things work in the software.
This is interesting. There's a question.
He's asking about 94 LA.
There's an interesting question from Ashish Parak. He says, if I file ITR in the old scheme, can I revise it with the new scheme? I think that's not allowed. But I think let me also see this. But ek bar preliminary jo mera answer hai iska, I think it will not be allowed. But let me have a rethink on that. Any chance of waiver of 234A interest at the portal is not ready. Abhi ITR ki date to hai, elapse hone dijiye. Abhi to we still have time. So baad mein agar portal ready nahi hai, to obviously date wo extend wagera karenge. So don't worry about that. I think Shubham, we have covered most of the. We've answered most of the questions. I think it's time to wind up.
Thank you so much for your wonderful presentation again, sir. And this topic was indeed very important, and we keep on getting requests about.
एक और आया, let me answer that.
Yeah, please. Sir.
देखिए, employer अगर कोई भी benefit आपको नहीं देता, चाहे वो HRA का benefit है, चाहे वो 89 के relief का benefit है, doesn't make a difference. You can always claim in the ITR. कोई आपका PPF का deduction आपका रह गया employer से. You can always claim in the ITR. No one stops you from doing that. Yeah, please continue, Shumo.
Right. So I was thanking Rajiv sir for his wonderful presentation and about topic in particular, wherein we keep on getting requests about this particular confusion between the old scheme and the new scheme, which completely haven't been resolved till now. Along with that. I would like to invite all the participants to continue the support at the day two of this series, wherein we'll have CA Pramod Janji, a very eminent faculty in direct taxation, and we'll have CA Ayush Mittal and CA Shreya Garwal from Coinman Consultants to be taking up the relevant topics of tomorrow related to the faceless assessments and analysis of higher TDS on non-filers under section 206AA, 206CA. And after that, on day three, we'll be having Charanjot Singh Nandaji, Central Council member, for the current issues related to foreign remittance. And along with that, we'll have the team from Lakshmi Kumaran and Sridharan, CA Bharati and CA Karanjot Singh, who will be taking the last session of our series, which will talk about the impact of recent amendments on M&A transactions. So don't forget to join us at day two and day three. And with this, I would again like to thank today's speaker, CA Rajiv Khandelwalji, with his presentation and his practical example on how to deal with the old versus new schemes, and also the team AFTP, along with the participants who have gathered in such a big number. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.